So far from the earlier videos, we have included name and email fields in the signup form with validations. The next field that we are going to implement is to capture the status of the individual who is signing up. The possible values for the status field are student, employed, and entrepreneur. Here, we are trying to capture the kind of user who is signing up into the website. Since this is a predefined list, we cannot capture this data from an input text element. We are going to include it as a drop-down list containing these three status values. In the HTML, this can be implemented using the select tag. Before starting with the implementation of this field, I would like to set the context on how this select tag is going to work end-to-end. For demonstrating this, I have created a sample HTML page named select.html. In this web page, I have recreated the signup page. We can see name, email, and the new status field. In the body of the HTML, there is a form tag. Within the form tag, we have the input text element for name. It has the name attribute value as name and defined as mandatory field using required attribute. In a similar fashion, email input text element is also defined. Next, we have the select tag for status. It is named as status. I wanted to make this field as mandatory field, hence required is included for the select tag as well. The select tag contains three options, each representing the status. Notice that each option tag is defined with value attribute having an unique number for each status. Now we will identify from where this data is going to come from. We will assume that the status data is defined in a relational database. The table name is status having two columns, ID and name. This table contains the status data with its respective ID. There is a backend REST API service that is going to read this data from status table and give it to the frontend as JSON. This is how the JSON format looks like that represents the data from status table. It defines an array. We can see the square brackets with each item in the array representing the status object having properties ID and name along with the respective value. The frontend application converts this JSON into JavaScript object array, and based on this JavaScript object array, the status drop-down list is populated. Based on this JavaScript object array, the option tags of the select tag are populated with value attribute having the ID of the status, and the status name is included as content of the option tag. In this HTML, I have not populated the data from JavaScript object, but directly included the option tags to demonstrate how it will look like after the data is populated. Hope this explanation helps you understand at a high level where the data for status drop-down list comes from and how the drop-down list is populated with status data. Now that we know how the drop-down list is populated, we will next focus on validation. Notice that all the three form elements, name, email, and status, are defined with required attribute. Let us see how the required attribute works in HTML. If I directly click on the submit button, we can see the browser showing an error message on the name input text element. Based on the HTML standards, the browser displays this message as required attribute is included in the name element. In Angular, the ng-model directive overrides this feature and prevents showing this message. Hence, we did not see these validation messages, but the internal ng-model object properties are modified to denote if the field is valid or not. I'm going to enter some data in the input text element. Now, if I click the submit button, we can see the error message on email input text element. I am entering some data in the email input text element. Now I am clicking on the submit button. The form has got submitted without showing any validation error messages. In the HTML, three option tags are included to represent each status. In the status drop-down list, the first item, student, is already selected. Since the drop-down list has some value selected, there is no validation errors and the form has got submitted without any errors. Here, there is a possibility that user may submit the form without applying the thought to select a status. To avoid this, I am going to include a new option tag as the first entry of the select tag. This will have the value as empty string and the content of the object tag as select status, which will get displayed as the first element in the drop-down list. I am saving the file. The web page gets automatically reloaded as this page is launched using Live Server extension. As first item in the drop-down list, we can see select status displayed. Now I am going to enter data into name and email field, then I am clicking on submit button. We can now see the validation error message displayed to select an item from the list. As per the HTML standards, in a select tag, if the selected option tag's value attribute is empty string, then it is considered as not selected and results in validation error on the form submission. To demonstrate this, let me change the value of the first option as 0 and save the file. Once the page reloads, I am changing some data for the name and then typing some data for email. Then without selecting anything in the status, I am clicking on the submit button. We can see the validation error message is not displayed and the form gets submitted. This clarifies that the option tag value should be an empty string for mandatory field validation. Hope this demonstration helps to understand how mandatory field validation can be implemented on a select tag. Next, we will focus on what happens when the form is submitted. I am going to enter some valid data in the form, typing name as John, then email as john@gmail.com, and then selecting employed option in the status dropdown. After entering the data, I am submitting the form. We can get the submitted form details from the browser URL. I am maximizing the browser window to view the form details in the URL. We can see name having whatever typed in name field. Then we can see email having whatever entered in the email field. Then for the status field, it has the ID of the selected status. For employed, the ID is 2, hence we see 2 submitted as value of status. In our Angular application, the form data will not be sent in the URL like this. The form data needs to be converted to JSON string and sent to the REST API service. This is how the JSON should look like. We can see the name property having whatever name typed by the user, then we have email having whatever typed by the user. For status, it is going to be an object having the status ID and status name. The backend REST API service should receive this JSON data and insert an entry into user table. Notice that for status column in the user table, it should insert the respective status ID. The backend REST API has to get the ID from the status object and use it when inserting into user table. In the user table, we can see the respective status ID included in the status column. This is how the status details will be stored in the user table. It will not store the status name, but stores only the status ID. Let me summarize in a diagram whatever discussed so far in this video. In this diagram, I will also highlight various steps that we need to take to implement the status drop-down list in the signup form of the Angular application. When the signup form is displayed, a request is sent in the background to make a REST API call to get the status details. The REST API makes the call to the database and gets the data from status table. The REST API then converts the data from status table into JSON string and sends it back to the Angular application. The Angular application should define a data type for status, hence a class should be defined based on which the array of status object should be created. We are not going to implement the backend part, hence definition of status data type and its array will be the first step that we will implement. The second step is to populate the dropdown list in the signup form HTML template based on the status array data defined in the first step. The third step is to implement the mandatory field validation. The fourth step is to implement how the form data is converted to JSON that will be sent when the form is submitted. Hope this video helps to understand the big picture about how we are going to implement the status dropdown list. In the next series of videos, we will implement these four steps one by one.